And did you guys circle around the
He's
same?
He's a licensed electrician, this guy over here.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that where you started? But you came out to California?
Oil rigs.
Well, no, I worked on oil rigs for a long time, and I got involved with this theater company that Ed put together, and we were up there installing this air conditioner. He showed up. We didn't really even say anything to each other for kind of like Hitch and Cole. We didn't really say much to each other for the whole day. Sat down at the end of the day and had a beer together and looked at each other and smiled.
It was love at first sight.
That kind of thing.
So, but what were you were doing oil rigs in what state? It wasn't LA.
No, and all over. I started in Oklahoma and I ended up in Kuwait.
Huh.
I didn't know you were in Kuwait.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I was in Kuwait when I was 23 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, I worked in Kuwait and all over the place.
Was it a completely, that must have been a little while ago.
Oh, yeah, a long time ago. Well, I was in college. I was an art student in college, and I took a summer job in the oil field, and I stayed there for 10 years.
Huh.
So.
But you always wanted to be an artist, ultimately?
Yeah, well, my grandparents were actors. They had a traveling tent show that followed the wheat harvest, and my mother and father were born on the show. So I always grew up around show business people, you know, crazy people, crazy characters, storytellers, musicians, actors, comedians, and I didn't want any part of it. So I went to work in the oil field, and I said, I'm going to get up there where the men are, do that sort of thing.
And you decided to come to LA anyway?
Well, no, anyway, the oil field crashed.
Yeah.
I didn't have anything else to do, and I told my mom, I said, you know, hey, there's this theater over there, and they're auditioning people for this play. I think I'm going to go in there and audition. She looked at me, her jaw dropped, and I walked in, and I got the part, and so here I am.
And the rest is history.
Yeah.
So when you guys met, were you kind of in the same group of actors trying to get the same parts? Were you competing with each other?
Oh, no, Ed was...
No, we had this theater group, my wife, Amy Maddie, Holly Hunter... Huh. Beth Henley, Pulitzer Prize winning playwright, Jimmy Gammon, Tom Bauer, were both in the film, a bunch of other really fine people. And we did plays there for a while.
So was this after Miss Firecracker had happened in New York and all that?
Yeah, this was, I'm trying to think, well, it was 1990 when we were
doing
that work there, but we kind of disbanded in mid-90s, you know, we tried to raise this great space in Santa Monica that we found. We split off, it was like 18 of us, and it was a board, and so you have these meetings, and like 9 of us were doing all the work and putting all the money into the place. We said, look, let us run the place. You guys can still do whatever you want, but let us run it. And we got met with so much animosity and acrimony, and when they called us the Hollywood elite, and we just basically said, see you later, we'll go find another spot. We found a great place on Main Street in Santa Monica, which is now
Larry Moss.
Larry Moss took it over. We had a $1.5 million capital campaign to build it, 2 theaters out, which we hired the architects, worked really very meticulously on the plans for these theaters, 99 seat, 70 seat. And we tried to raise the money. We raised $200,000.
And that was that.
And then we said,
And then you became more the Hollywood elite, or were you?
No, then we just got too old and didn't have the energy to keep pursuing the theater thing. It would have been a great place, though. We had some really great people, and the network of people that we knew that could have come in and created work there could have been fantastic. But, just couldn't pull it off.
Ed and I didn't know each other in Oklahoma, but Ed's mother and father were from Oklahoma. My mother and father were from Oklahoma. And I think it's really interesting that Ed's first play was in a theater that my mother was involved in.
Jewel
in
Box
Oklahoma
theater,
called
Oklahoma
the Jewel Box.
City.
The Jewel Box Theater, and where were you? Played
King Arthur. Camelot.
He knocked on Mom and Dad's door and said, hey, I'm King Arthur, and they said, that's cool, we're Mom and Dad.
No, that was the worst telling of that story that I ever heard.
You tell me.
I came home after the second call back, and I went, and they were living in Norman, it was a university, and they were sleeping, and I said, I was pretty excited, and I went in there, and I said, Dad and Mom, I said, I'm King Arthur, and they said, oh, I think we know you, we're the Harrises from Oklahoma City. because they were like asleep. You know, they didn't know what they were talking about. It was kind of funny at the time, but it, boy.
Sorry.
Yeah.
You need a bigger room.
Yeah, I'm sorry, man. Excuse me.
So that's no problem.
So Hitch and Cole were kind of inevitable, the way this is going.
A little bit, yeah. Well, we, you know, when we're writing this guys together, when we're writing the script, and we're taking the, using the book, obviously, and a lot of the dialogue, most of it's out of the book, but you're still editing it, and you're working on these two characters. I mean, you know, we'd read it together, and, you know, you could sense what's necessary, what isn't, where the pauses or where the beats in the scenes are, you know, where the humor is and stuff. So, yeah, it was really fun. We had a really good time working on it.
And this is a big challenge to get the movie made. I mean, this is, I would assume, it's tough.
Yeah,
to get
it took a little while, you know. I mean, it, you know, in the reality, and you look at it in terms of making a, getting a picture made in Hollywood, I guess, or in, you know, the movie business, it's not, didn't take that long. It took a year and 3 months, maybe. But I was saying, Bobby and I were talking the other day, and it was every day of that year and 2 and 3 months was trying to get this thing financed. In other words, you're on the phone with somebody literally every one of those days, other than the weekends probably, where you're either bitching about the, you know, the money, the budget, what we need, what we can't need, who you got to cast, who you don't have to cast. I mean, it's constant fight, different people going overseas, trying to get their foreign monies to say, this is your budget, this is how much we can give you. That's not enough, I can't make the movie for that. Well, sorry, you know, you go to the next person, blah, blah, blah. And it's just, it's, so, it, you know, it was painstaking, but it was totally worth it. I mean, it's just what you gotta do if you wanna get a picture financed.
Is there anything fun about being a producer? Is there any good part of it?
Yeah, you get to hire people you wanna work with, you know, in terms of the crew and the department heads, the DP, the wardrobe, the, well, electrician, I mean, the head, you know, the head lighting people, and everybody, the head wrangler, the, you know, whatever. I mean, you know, you're...
We had a good time putting together the town.
Mm-hmm.
And
the town itself?
Yeah, and working in the art direction. It was...
You know, you're in, but your hands are in everything.
But you have Jeremy Irons in a supporting role, you have Renee in a supporting role, and Vigo, who's become, you know, a major star in the last couple of years in particular, all there kind of out there scraping along, because this is a relatively low-budget picture, right?
Yeah, relatively, you know. I mean, we had enough to do it, but it wasn't luxurious by any means.
So were they all the first calls? Was that the,
yeah, and they all worked for, you know, nothing, basically.
So is Vigo, you knew Vigo from History of Violence?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I had really enjoyed working with him on that, you know.
He seems, the poet thing with him is always there. We actually did an interview, and he still had his goatee from this. He came back to do an interview for something else, and he, you know, gave me a Kurt Vonnegut book as he was leaving the room, left some poetry in his wake.
Yeah, no, he has this publishing company, you know, which he's like the guy. I mean, he publishes poets, he publishes photographs, he publishes stuff that he's written, you
his
know.
His own artwork music, and his own music. You know. Definitely a renaissance guy.
Yeah.
But you guys didn't have a lot of time to put together the Hitch and Cole relationship.
You not really. I mean, but one of the reasons I asked Vigo to do it, and one of the things I believed he would bring to it, is the fact that the two of us could sit there, not say a word to each other, and you believe that these guys have been buddies for 12 years, you know? I mean, just something about how I felt with him, working with him, little I got to know him. You know, Vigo's a very private guy, and I am too, pretty much, but there's a, it's not about your private life, it's about your private, there's something, there's still a way to share your privacy without sharing facts about mm-hmm. your private life, you know what I mean? You can mm-hmm. still be intimate with somebody and not be talking to them all the time and telling them all your problems mm-hmm. and worries and et cetera, et cetera. And getting into your relationships or whatever. I mean, you know.
Do you know that?
It's not like we don't talk about stuff, right. But it's not that, you know.
Were you guys?
Yeah. Well, it's not just that. I mean, Robert and I probably, you know, we talk a lot more about personal things than Vigo and I do, mm-hmm. you know.
Do you know that with an actor the minute you meet them or when you've worked with them for a little bit? I mean, do you get that sense of how it's going to be when you're working together on a show?
Yeah, to tell you the truth. I mean, tonight I was just at this fundraiser, you know, for the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, and there are a couple of actors that are very, very well known.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to mention their names. And I had never really met either one of them. They're you know, a little younger than me, but not much. Mm-hmm. And I said hello. And I could tell right off the bat that both of them were not people that were totally accessible.
Mm-hmm.
As people or as actors. At least that's mm-hmm. the way I felt.
You gotta write that quickly. Have you become more forgiving or less
not
forgiving?
Not that first impressions are always correct.
Well, have they traditionally, but most of the time.
Most of the time you get a pretty good hit off somebody,
yeah.
where they're coming from.
Have you become more relaxed about people that way and as you've gotten older or less so? I mean, you're a veteran, you've seen, you know,
I've become more relaxed with myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I was at this affair, you know, saying hi to Barbara Streisand, who I met, and Al Gore and Nancy Pelosi and all these people. That's like, you know, kind of like a fish out of water in a way.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, it's like, I felt fine. I don't think I wasn't embarrassing myself. I was standing there breathing and standing erect and like going hello, looking people in the mm-hmm. eye and seeming like a sane human being. But it was also like, get me the fuck out of here. You know? It's awkward.
It's just not your room.
No.
But I mean, you're obviously of a political belief.
Yeah, and that's why I was there.
But do you, I mean, what do you think about the idea of celebrities using that
commodity? You know, the way it is right now?
Yeah.
Use whatever you got to get these people out of there. That's the way I'm looking at it. I mean, it might turn some people off, but it might also turn some people on. And if you're being asked the question and you're somewhat of a public figure, you got every right to respond any way you want to. People don't have to listen to you, but, you know.
So the relationship of Hitch and Cole, going back to the movie.
Yeah.
Very intimate, very kind of, you know, kind of like a tag team act. In some ways.
Well, you were saying Laurel and Hardy the
well,
other
really,
night.
Yeah. I watched the movie for a second time, and I thought, really, that, you know, Viggo is kind of the quiet guy.
Yeah, he's kind of a straight guy, I guess, but it's kind of weird because we're both kind of the straight guy in a way, but it...
But your anger is so defined, and his is kind of, he's a little bit more...
Well, yeah, you know, as much as Cole says feelings get you killed, he probably exhibits more feelings,
yeah.
you know.
Well, so did Hardy.
Yeah.
But you don't look anything like him.
did they ever do a Western where they played cowboys?
They did, Way Out West, I think. It was a great one. Actually.
I mean, were they dressed up in the Western gear?
I think they had the chaps on and the whole thing.
I kind of remember.
We're going to have
that.
To look it up now.
I know Abbott and Costello did that.
Yeah.
I don't know about Laurel and Hardy.
Well, you guys, I mean, I'm watching this movie. You guys, you and Viggo, really, I still think should be in every movie. Like any movie Hollywood makes, they should find a role for the two of you together and just going to let you do something. Yeah.
It'd be fun.
Well, the idea of an ensemble, I mean, you were talking about it with a play, with a theater company.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of a little bit lost these days. I mean, Cronenberg actually kind of keeps his actors together. And
yeah.
You've used
some. I mean, if I used, I mean, you know, Tom Bowers, for instance, who plays one of the old, he's been in every film. Well, not, I mean, I produced one Western and I directed a couple other films.
Mm-hmm.
And he'd been in all three of those. And, you know, I've worked with a lot of actors at the same time. At the same time, whether it's theater or some other things, but it would be fun. You know, I was talking to Susan Sarandon one night, not to drop names, but whereas at the screening of this film of our film in New York,
mm-hmm.
and we were talking about the election and all that, going back to politics just briefly, and she was saying that she and Tim, her husband, were thinking about where they would move if, in fact, McCain won the election, and I got the idea. It was probably not an original one. But if in fact he did, which he's not going to, because I do not believe the American people are that foolish, but we shall see. I got the idea that you get hundreds of people, actors, writers, dancers, musicians, you know, who are fed up with the situation. And if McCain wins, you all get out. You all move en masse. You figure it out. You get organized,
mm-hmm.
and you just move the whole artistic community to I don't know where,
mm-hmm.
Canada, Ireland, Australia. I don't know.
People talked about it more with the second Bush election, but I think
it's
really
yeah,
down to
no,
it.
It's getting kind of serious now. Yeah.
The idea of a third time is kind of stunning. Well, this film actually is a little political. The third act of the picture, kind of, I don't want to give away too much, but the bad guys kind of become part of the mainstream. Much of the shock, I think,
yeah,
the audience.
Yeah, you know, the thing, the one scene that I really miss, the image that I really miss, is the Jeremy Irons character, when he does come back, standing in this town meeting hall with an American flag over here and a one of those little quilty frame things saying,
mm-hmm.
remember thy creator up behind his head, and giving this rap to the townspeople about how he's a changed man and how he's going to invest his money in the town. Everybody's going to get rich and everybody's going to be happy. Because that was the most political image that we shot in the whole movie, but we didn't need the scene, so it's not in there.
So how much was cut out of the picture? Was there much?
Well, you know, I think the original script was 100 and...
15, 16 pages?
Yeah, 14, 15 pages, and there's probably...
100 pages in it?
Yeah,
98. Maybe a little less.
Probably cut out a good 15, 17
15 pages.
So how did Jeremy get involved with the picture?
Well, I wanted him to do it, and I was in London shooting National Treasure, you know, and called him, and he's represented by agent, the same agency, and we got together, and he had read the script and liked it a lot, and we sat over a cup of tea, actually, a few biscuits, and talked about it, and told him why I wanted him to do it, and he was excited about it, and so it worked out.
Does doing a movie like National Treasure, is that like a vacation for you, or just kind of go in and get it done?
Well, you know, it was actually kind of cool, because we shot in London, we shot, you know, in near Mount Rushmore, South Dakota, shot here. Where else was I? I guess that was maybe it. But, you know, it was a long shoot, and I would work for a while, and then I'd go home for 3 weeks, and I'd go work for a while and go home. So it was, in terms of my family life, it was great.
Right.
And it's also, you know, it helps, you know, you do want your daughter to go to a good school if possible, and education costs a little bit. So.
But just functionally working on a machine that big compared to something like Appaloosa where it's really,
well,
you know,
yeah, I mean, you really just show up and you do your job. I mean, you know.
The big trailers.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, no,
they definitely, Jerry treats his actors really nicely, Bruckheimer.
Yeah.
Definitely.
It seems very easygoing. It seems like it never gets too ruffled on his shows.
No, and John Turteltaub, you know, he's managing this, he's directing this huge thing, and he's very cool about it. You know, you never, I mean, he might be under pressure, but you never feel it, you know.
Yeah.
But what is incredible about that kind of situation, though, is the money that just flies. It's just like flying. I mean, I don't mean in your, you know, it's just like nothing matters.
Yeah.
If the film's $120 million, $160 million budget, you know, what's the difference? It's going to make $400 million.
I mean,
it's shocking, especially when during that you're trying to get this thing financed.
Right.
You know.
You're like giving the budget for them.
For
the week.
And the difference is just is shocking. Yeah. You know, and you just go, wow.
Would you want to make one of those?
No. I wouldn't know how to.
It just wouldn't, because it wouldn't connect with you personally.
I wouldn't know how to film it. You know what I mean? All the effects and everything, it would blow my mind. I mean, I wouldn't mind working with the actors on something like that. I got nothing against this kind of movie. But, you know, for you could make 5 Appaloosas, or probably 8 of them, for what it costs to make National Treasure.
Do you want to make one for?
A National Treasure?
A massive movie. I mean, I don't need to pick on National Treasure.
No,
National
not at all.
Hey, if I could write one, it would work. My mind doesn't work that way, though.
No, mine either.
You like the small stories.
Well, the character.
Character-driven stuff is what I like.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be small.
I was thinking...
I don't consider this small, Dave.
Right.
You know. I mean, it's an intimate story, but the landscape's pretty great. I mean, I think it's got really good production value.
Well, the sets are, the sets, you know? The outdoors are amazing.
Yeah.
Where you shot it in New Mexico?
Yeah, outside Santa Fe.
And was it easy to find were these used locations that have been used over and over again, or was this...
Well, you know,
territory?
That we were aware that some had, and we didn't use those.
Yeah,
you know, that was the first question we asked. You know?
We avoided that a bit, but we had some incredible locations up in the Abiquiu Chama River, north of Santa Fe, and then the Ford Ranch is where the town is, Appaloosa.
Mm-hmm. Which is the burnt down ranch from
originally
Silverado?
It was Silverado, and then they did. The Will Smith, was that movie? The Wild Wild West.
Oh.
And when they shot that movie there, the whole town burnt down.
Which is a sign.
Happened. There was a fire. You know, burnt the whole thing, and they rebuilt it.
It was an electrical thing.
Yeah.
So you guys, did you have the freedom to put together whatever you wanted were there? Was it stuff already rebuilt?
Well, there were some very, you know, I mean, a lot of the buildings were where they were and where they were going to stay.
Mm-hmm.
There were a number of them that we could move. We actually, lifted them up and moved them.
Mm-hmm.
There were some half kind of partially constructed buildings that we just tore down.
Mm-hmm.
And then we built some structures. We changed the facades on almost every building, changed the colors, obviously, changed what the stores were. I mean, it was just really just buildings when we got there. Built a lot of boardwalks, sidewalks if we needed to. We brought in trees. You know, mm-hmm. we did a lot of work on
all the exteriors and interiors were, or the interiors were the actual location of the exterior.
So there weren't walls being taken out?
No, well it, like the Boston House, the exterior of the Boston House,
right.
You know, a lot of times in films, you know, you'll have an exterior and then the interior will be on a set or in
right.
some other location, but they were all, the interior of the Boston House was the Boston
House. It was not that it was the most lively town in the world, but I always wanted to feel that it was, when you're in one of these rooms, that the town's out there. You're
mm-hmm.
always seeing through windows and seeing somebody go by or hearing a carriage go by or whatever. So, I mean, you know, these guys were in this town, and the movie's called Appaloosa, so you wanted to feel that there was such a place.
Well, one of the things I completely noticed about the movie is that Cole's already sitting in front of the window, even as he's about to be shot down. There always seems to be a lot of open space and open windows.
In the Earl Mays saloon, he's by the window because he's keeping an eye on the town, and he's
right.
just by the other window.
For the sheriff's office, the shades are up until pretty late in the picture.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Didn't think about that too much.
No, I definitely thought about it.
I'm reading into your work here.
No, I definitely thought about it, but first of all, he's there with his partner most of the time. And that scene, the one scene where he's there and the shades are up at night, is when those guys have left that day, and he's sitting by his thing and he hears a noise and he comes outside and looks. I mean, you know, to me, it's like, yeah, somebody could take a pot shot at him, but they don't, you know. Good question. What can I tell you?
So you're open to a romantic interest in this one, and Renee Zellweger coming into town.
Yes.
And just, I mean, it seems to be like a big part of what the movie is about is Cole deciding that this is where the direction he's going to go, no matter what happens, almost.
Uh huh.
Is that fair to say?
Sure. Yeah.
The woman, the timing, the circumstance. The age?
It's like the song at the end. He says, I don't care what you do. I don't care what you say. There's a truth inside you somewhere that doesn't have to play at being scared and lonely. And you don't have to act so damn loose. You know, I know that's not really you.
Mm.
Cole thinks that about her. This is a special person that he's fallen in love with. And he knows she behaves oddly,
mm-hmm.
and hasn't been the most faithful partner, but I think he's holding out hope that she'll see the light.
Is that what you have to take into marriage in general, you think?
God,
every
I
marriage?
Hope not.
It should be easier than that.
Yeah.
And how was Renee? I mean, picking Renee was...
See, what's great about Renee is she's not known as like a sexual being, you
right.
know? I mean, she's very sensual. She got a great body on her. I find her tremendously erotic. I like being around her as a man. I felt good to be next to her, gotta tell you the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that might not come across on the screen in terms of other guys looking at her. You know, what I'm saying is she could be a little androgynous at times, actually.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with the way her hair was and, you know, and the wardrobe and stuff. But this is a woman. She's got a dollar in her pocket and she's her husband's dead and she's gotten as far as she could and she's left in this town. She's not some bombshell vamp, you know,
mm-hmm.
manipulating, calculating, you know, sexy kitten, cat, stripper, bitch, you know. She's a woman that's
mm-hmm.
left here. And she's scared and she's doing what she can do to survive,
mm-hmm.
you know, period.
Is that something that the studio wanted you to change, or anybody has poked at you to change?
They didn't understand that, you know.
Because it was too human.
Yeah, basically. They wanted her not to do the things that she did, that that make people uncomfortable about her, or that make people not like her. They didn't want her doing those things. That's the character. That's what she's forced to do from her point of view to survive in this situation. And the fact that there's humor about it, see, it works for the film in one way, but it kind of works against her character in another way, because it makes her almost a clown or an object of derision, you know? Like when Cole says, you know, she says, "You believe him over me," and Cole goes, "That's correct," and everybody laughs. It's very funny,
yeah.
But it's at her expense, which isn't quite fair. You know what I mean? But that's kind of the dynamic of the film.
Well, at that moment, you really choose not to like her. I think. And, I mean, the audience.
It's not about not liking her. It's like, I know Hitch is not lying to me.
Right.
I don't even care what you say. Hitch is not going to lie to me.
Mm-hmm.
Period.
Right.
So if you're gonna make it between Hitch and you, yeah, he's telling the truth. I don't know what you're saying, but he's telling the truth.
Of course, Hitch has a relationship with an actual prostitute.
Yeah.
Which in some ways feels almost more, less complicated, I guess, but more.
Well,
there's an intimacy between them that's very, very real.
Well, there's an honesty between them,
and
that's a woman that's not scared. This is a woman that knows who she is, comfortable with herself in a situation, has been here for however long, and found a man that she really is comfortable with, and vice versa. Okay? Allie's not that woman. Allie's like going, I want to be that. I want to be comfortable. But I don't know. I mean, what happens if Virgil gets killed? You know? What happens if he leaves me? You know? He hasn't been around. He's watching the prisoner. Here's his buddy. Do you think I'm pretty? You know, just hold me for a second. Somebody just protect me. Let me feel safe, you know. Now, granted, you could go into that a lot deeper in the story. You could spend a lot more time with that. You could probably articulate that better. And, you know, in hindsight, it probably could have penetrated that character a little bit more, her character. But we didn't. And I was probably, as a director, to tell you the truth, more concerned about keeping the story moving, deepening the relationship between my character and Hitch's. And I might have let a few things slide, to tell you the truth.
But you have a lot of beats without a lot of words that really define her in that way. I mean, there's the attempt to touch you at one point where...
Right. Even and this is not... I'm not putting this on Renee at all either. This is shit I was thinking about today, to tell you the truth.
But it seems like even late in the picture, there was a moment where you see remorse in her eyes about what she might be doing or might consider doing. And
oh,
you really
yeah.
feel her pain.
No,
you know?
When she's at the piano by herself there, after the guy comes in, puts his hand on her neck, I love that shot. I mean, I love what she's just sitting there. She's just going, she doesn't know what to do.
She's lost.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
And she's got this is her boss. Her guy is probably not going to have a job, you know. She knows that. She's not dumb. And she's going, here I go again. She's not walking up those stairs happy, you know. So, you know.
But you're kind of a tough guy in the movies. It seems like to me like you always have remarkable insight into women in your work. You seem to really like women.
I do like women. I like women a lot. You know, I really appreciate women very much, and more so as the years go by.
Why as the years go by?
Just as you grow older, you learn more, you know? I mean, I just think that they're basically less confused than men on some level. I don't know if that makes any sense.
It does. We're trying differently. So the two of you, do you think this is the beginning of the producing directing team of the next 20 years, or are you ready to jump on this horse again? It's just a matter of finding the right material.
Material helps. So Robert's written some great screenplays, you know. I mean, really interesting. The one about his family, the tent players, you know. So there are a lot of things. And the John Wesley Harden thing he wrote is it's out there, man. There's some pretty cool stuff.
We could have some good things to do. Maybe there's two more of the Robert Parker's books that carry on with Hitch and Cole and Allie, and it'd be great to get into those.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, for me personally, I'm not speaking for Robert here. For me to get behind the camera and take on that kind of thing, it just has to be like this thing that's like intuitive, that is compelling, that's a compulsion, that it's undeniable. It's like, you got
to
do it.
You
so
have
you
to
do
it.
It.
Yeah.
Well, we appreciate each time you do it.
Yeah.
So far, so good.
I hope to do some more.
Well, thank you so much.
Yeah, good talking with you, Dave.
Thank you, Dan.
Good talking to you.